Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome and thank you very much for taking your time to come to our session on secure BYOD applications using secure portable workspace and Microsoft Windows to go. How many of you have been tired of carrying 3 or 4 computers every time you have to do a demo or a presentation? No, for us, that's the same problem as well. We've, just to set this demo up, we've had to have 6 computers. The good news is we now have computer in that form factor, and you can easily carry it in your computers. For this presentation, we've only brought 2 computers to do that. Just introducing ourselves, with me is my colleague, Nadia Vostrikov. She's our software support engineer with 12 years of software integration development experience, as well as putting together encryption solutions for complex environments. Nadia.
And Bobada, our managing director as well as practice manager, with more than 12 years of experience in encryption solution design and consulting for major customers in Australia and Asia-Pac.
Thank you. Here's the agenda for today. We will look at the market forces that are demanding the need for secure portable workspace when it comes to mobility and BYOD. And we will then take an in-depth dive into the technology itself. And we will provide demonstration as well. And I'm sure you'll have question and answers, so we would very much appreciate if question and answers were left to the end. We've allocated 15 minutes for that. Do we all like freebies as well? Do we like freebies as well?
Yes.
Fantastic. So we do have 3 freebies to give away today. In order to qualify to win that, all you have to do is stay here till the end. I just briefly wanted to introduce our companies. Rentronics is an Australian company, head office in the Silicon Valley, North Ryde. Our company has been selling encryption solutions for the past 12 years, and we are using technologies developed by Rentronics as well as imported technologies to provide complex encryption solutions. Our relationship with Spirus is that we are the distributor and the local supporter for the technology. Spirus is the provider or the manufacturer of the secure portable workplace hardware device. They've been in business for about 20 years. Company is head office in San Jose, California, and their specialty is in developing encryption technologies, and they've been doing that for the past 20 years. Their claim to fame is made in USA products, so the entire technology, the chips, the memory controllers, the flash drives, the software are all manufactured in America, and from a secure premises as well, because certain customers, such as defense, for instance, as well as commercial customers, are nowadays demanding high security assurance products, and I'm talking about without any malware from the technology. How many of you have actually used BYOD and understand BYOD? A few, that's good. When it comes to building a BYOD and mobility solutions, one needs to have a highly secure environment. You want to be able to build a high trust. And when we look at BYOD and mobility, we look at 5 forces in BYOD and mobility. The first one is employees, you and me basically. There's the employers. There's the technology innovators such as Microsoft, for instance, and other companies as well. There's privacy regulators as well. And then there's, guess what, the criminal element, people who'd like to steal your data. Let's look at them in a little bit more detail. So the first one over here is you and I would love to be able to have the freedom of working anywhere, any place, anytime. Due to consumerization, we would like to use our favorite toys. So I'm using a smartphone. In this instance, happens to be an iPhone instead of a company-supplied BlackBerry phone. And I have my own laptop as well, a highly spec i7 12 gigs of RAM, 256 gig SSD, high resolution screen, 12 hours of battery life, and so on and so on. Suffice to say, I am running some of my own personal applications as well as corporate applications in that. So, you know, there is a chance that I am risking companies' corporate data. There are innovations, and there's innovations happening at a very fast rate. Specifically, I'd like to look at two of the innovations, Microsoft Windows to Go, which is available in Windows Enterprise 8, and we'll talk a little bit about more on that technology itself. The most important thing is that it adds an added ease of use, ease of provisioning when it comes to mobility and BYOD applications. The other one is the growth in cloud. It's so easy to now provision servers, applications, have more bandwidth, scale up and down, and it literally takes minutes to do them. Now, if you want to transfer big files to a third party, it's pretty easy. You can use SkyDrive, you can use Dropbox, and you are able to send 100 megs of file to a third party. Certainly, it's easy to transfer confidential data using such technologies as well. If you look at some of the newspaper articles that are available recently, and other credible organizations such as the report from Ponemon Institute, and the report was written this year, and I'm talking specifically about Australian enterprises over here, as well as the Verizon report, they all are saying one thing. There's a substantial increase in attacks. There's substantial increase and substantial breach of data in Australia. And the other slide, the other aspect is the increase in espionage as well. Now, you might say it's airy-fairy, you know, CIA movies and so on, but if you look at the Verizon report, they are talking about certain countries that are deliberately attempting to steal intellectual property from startup companies as well as large companies. So this is real, and it's happening at a faster rate than you can think. And I can certainly send you copies of this report by third party, and I'll send you the URL. The enterprises have to comply with privacy regulations that are put out. So certainly the enterprises are enjoying the productivity improvement that you would get from users who can work anywhere, anytime, any place, as well as using their own devices because they are very familiar with their device. However, they are carrying what I call regulated data. So regulated data by definition would be data such as credit card data for which they have to meet PCI DSS compliance, for instance, or payment card industry standard. They might be having personal identifiable data such as bank account numbers, tax file numbers, health records, and so on. So you need to meet the Australian data privacy standard. And these standards carry real fines. If you look at the Ponemon Institute report, and I'm talking about the Australian companies, not the big companies, on average I'm talking about smaller companies, I'm not talking about the banks and the large insurance companies, they carry on average 200,000 records. The figure that has been quoted in the report is $141 per record compromised or breached. So a company that is carrying 200,000 records, their financial risk is $2.8 million. So that's substantial. Now, if you are breached, there is reputational damage, loss of customers as well, and potentially closure of your business as well. So really, for the enterprises, they have to be very careful and they have to take steps whilst all these enabling technologies are coming in and people are wanting to use more and more BYOD and mobility. I have a question for you. How many of you have actually used Microsoft Windows to Go? So we have a few people here. This is good. This is good. Makes my life a little bit easier. Microsoft has released this new feature in Windows 8 Enterprise Edition. This particular feature eases the use of BYOD and mobility applications. Specifically, it allows you to copy your corporate or laptop image on a USB stick, basically, or flash drive or Windows to Go drive. So your image is copied on that, and you are then able to boot off any Windows 7, 8, Mac machine, anywhere. The feature is easy to use, easy to deploy, and centrally you can centrally manage and control your applications as well. Here are some of the use cases for the technology. The first one is contractors. So if you have a contractor working remotely, all you have to do is provision your corporate image into one of these drives, your SOE applications, send it across to the contractor. The contractor is then able to use his laptop, Windows 7 or 8 or Mac, and is able to then do all the things that you would expect an employee to do in the office. That contractor does not need to install any additional software or applications on this device. It's ready to go. And at the termination or at the completion of the contract, he returns this back to you, and you are able to then reprovision that for another contractor. As easy as that. We talked about me having my own laptop, and these days certainly I have corporate image on that, and I'm able to take my laptop to work and are able to run corporate applications from a secure environment. People do like to travel light these days, so if you happen to be traveling from one office to the other or one country to another, it's far, far easier for you to be provided with a provisioned USB stick. And when you do go to the other office, you are able to boot off any available machine and have your familiar Windows 8 environment to run all your corporate applications. I mean, in this instance, the picture shows a lady carrying her handbag. These days, it's easy to carry a computer in a handbag. I'm a typical male. I just carry them in my pocket. Last week, I met a CIO in Brisbane of a fairly large company. And what he said to me was this, that the permanent office, the permanent desk, the permanent phone, the permanent computer has taken a permanent holiday. What they have now is a pool of shared desktops, and what they've done is provisioned for their employees one of these, and on a first-come, first-served basis, they are able to use the available computer. So they come to work, they do what they have to do, take this out, go home. The next day they come back again, and they might be using yet another computer in that same office. And it's as easy as that. What we'll do now is take a deeper dive into the technology, and Nadia will provide more details for you. Please do stay over here. We are giving away three cards at the end.
Thank you, Bob. It's very good to see you all here. Thank you for coming. So Bob talked about the challenges of BYOD and how Windows to Go can solve some of these challenges. And I will tell you a little bit about how we can secure and protect that Windows to Go environment using hardware encryption from Spire's Secure Portable Workplace. Spire's Secure Portable Workplace, or I'm going to call it SPW, was the first hardware encrypting device that Microsoft certified for Windows to Go use. It allows user to have and boot a self-contained operating system directly from the USB device. It's very small in size, but I think Bob showed you. It's very small. Really, you can put it in your pocket, or I can put it in my bag. And have you ever wondered what women carry in their bags? If you look at my bag, you can find everything. And the only thing I think was missing was the computer. And now I can carry my computer in my bag. So I have even more things to carry. So even though it comes in a USB format, in a USB flash format, it still has very, very good performance and speed. It's designed for USB 3.0 with solid-state drive performance. It's very easy to provision for multiple users, and it has zero footprint on your host computer. And I will talk about these elements on the next slide. So this device supports all features of Windows to Go. So what you need to do, you just take this USB device, find any dead laptop or desktop, plug it, this device into the USB port, and boot from that. And here we are. We have full Windows 8 experience. So as I mentioned, it supports USB 3.0, but it's also compatible with 2.0 if you have older PC. The operating system on the device uses hardware resources from the host computer. Some of them, for example, CPU, RAM, mouse, keyboard, network card. But what it does not use, it's a hard disk of the host PC. It never connects to the hot disks. The hard disk stays isolated all the time. And the operating system from this device never accesses it. And because it does not connect to the hard disks, you won't be contaminated and infected from the host machine, even if it's infected with viruses and malware. And after you finish your work, you just shut down this USB, this OS on this USB, take your device out, and go home. And never. Nobody would ever know that you worked on that PC. So it's actually zero footprint. As Bob mentioned, this device, as all other Windows to Go devices, can boot on hardware that's certified for Windows 7 or higher, so it can be Vista or Windows 8. But Spyrus devices also can boot on some Apple computers. So if you're in infrastructure manager and you're struggling with how to enable BYOD for your employees who have Apple computers at home, this is the answer. So you just give these devices to them and you basically can convert their Apple computers into Windows computers. The Spyrus Secure Portable Workplace is designed to provide a high assurance processing environment to the user, so they know that they can trust the environment they work on. And to do that, this TIG provides a lot of security features up to the highest defense level. So first of all, they have very high security XTS ES256-bit full disk encryption. And full disk encryption means that the entire operating system, all Windows files, all application data, all user files are encrypted and stayed protected while they're addressed. Also, all the encryption, which is happening inside the device, is provided by the hardware chip embedded in the device. And that chip was also developed by Spyrus specifically to ensure that all cryptographic operations such as encryption, digital signing, key management are done natively on the stick within the hardware. So the encryption flow never leaves this device. All the encryption algorithms are based on Suite B set. And Suite B set is a set of encryption algorithms which provide the highest level of security up to top secret level. And this Suite B set is recommended for federal governments and defense organizations. Also, FIPS 140-2 level 3, certification means that this device is tamper-proof and tamper-resistant. So if somebody tries to open it and go directly to the storage and try to read the data directly from the storage, all encryption keys will be deleted and destroyed, and they cannot decrypt the data from the storage. If your company has a policy to enforce Microsoft BitLocker, go ahead and do it. You'll get double layer of protection. And with this device, you can even get hardware encryption for your BitLocker keys. When I was a kid, I loved open toys and radios and all the devices to see how they work. And if you're like me, probably you would like to know what's inside. And this is a very basic picture of that. So as you can see, there are a lot of different chips and elements. And so, as I mentioned, the core element of this device is encryption chip. This Rosetta Micro chip developed by Spares that provides all encryption operations. This chip encrypts the storage and decrypts the data when it's needed by operating system. Also, it has security boundary, as you can see. This is epoxy layer that provides that physical security for tamper-proof. Also, if we look at the memory architecture, you can see that it has two partitions. One blue one is clear partition, and the orange one is encrypted partition. The clear partition is needed to boot the device before it gets decrypted. So in the clear partition, if you look at it, you'll see that it has master boot record, it has partition table, it has a tough boot loader, which is also developed by Spares to provide the integrity checks and authentication to the device. In encryption partition, you can have up to three segments. The first, of course, it's OS boot partition, where we need to put Windows bootloader. The second partition is Windows operating system partition, where you have Windows operating system files, all application files, and user data. That partition is encrypted. And for additional security, you can get it in read-only mode to have better control over your users if you don't want them to install any application and change your SUE environment on this stick. And the third partition, which is optional, the separate partition can be configured for user data. And that partition is separately encrypted and protected. So let me show you a little bit of demo and how we can boot from the device and what's the process. So I have my stick here, and let me show you my computer. So here I have Windows 7 Professional, which I'm going to use as a host computer and boot my Windows 8 environment. So first I need to shut it down. It will take a little bit, a few seconds. So I'm shutting down. And then I plug in my device into USB port that I have on my available on my computer. So then I need to switch to this one, as it's tricky to protect the booting process. So I have another camera here, and let me boot from the device. How we can see something over there. So, all right, so let me adjust this camera. So when you boot this device, the first thing it does, it checks all the hardware and firmware to ensure that nothing has been tampered with and everything's operational. Once all checks passed, it will load the tough boot loader into the memory and presents the authentication string to the user. So here, user needs to provide the correct password, of course. And, what's going on? think was... So the text didn't pass, so it's... Wrong password again, sorry guys. Is it the wrong device? That's no, it's the right device. So now we can, probably I can switch to this one if I can switch to this back. Or can we see anything? No, I have to switch it back to this one. Oh, it's number three. Sorry, too many cameras. So I have my Windows 7, 8, and I'll try to switch to another one. And switch it back. Okay, here we go. So here I have my Windows 8 computer. And after you boot, you'll see the normal Windows 8 environment. Depending on which image you use to create this device. So depending on the image, you have your corporate applications or you have to install applications by yourself from the Windows App Store and from the Internet.
Nadia, I have a question for you.
Yes?
So you're telling me that you are using SWIDB cryptography, XTS, AES 256-bit. You are encrypting my Windows Enterprise 8 operating system, and you are encrypting my data as well. I'm really concerned because it looks like I'm going to be losing the performance that I'm used to on my laptop. Will you be slowing down my applications?
That's a good question. Yes, because sometimes people think that if you encrypt all the data, it really slows down the system. But yes, we encrypt all the entire storage inside the USB. But as I mentioned, it provides the USB 3.0 level speed, and also it has SSD storage inside. So as Bob, I will show you the example that will, you know, show you, demonstrate that you won't really lose any performance. So I have my video here, which was the the standard Microsoft video with wildlife. And if you can see the normal video without any of the delays and pauses, so you'll see the experience that you would have on your normal laptop and desktop. So even though my laptop is quite old and has USB 2 port, so it still has a great performance.
Wow, I'm impressed, Nadia.
All right, so let's continue. So now, yeah, so we've seen how we can boot from the device. And the next question is, how do we create this awesome tool? So for you who already been using Windows to go with other products, you might know that Microsoft provides their own provisioning tool to create and provision these devices. However, that tool is only can be used for non-encrypted devices. So with Spyrus SPW, you must use Spyrus provisioning tool. And that tool is specifically designed for these encrypted devices. Also, to provision these USB sticks, you must use 64-bit Windows 8 Enterprise Edition.
Sorry, can I ask questions? There's different manufacturers on the market of the USB sticks. You're saying that they're all encrypted, so would they all require proprietary software to create the image? Because you might say, okay, well, I'm going to use these ones, and then, okay, well, these ones are half the price in a year's time, so I'll start using those ones. Would you have to buy new tools?
So could I, would it be okay if I answer that question right at the end?
Yeah.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Please write it down, Bob, so we don't forget. Yes, so we'll answer your question at the end. But for these devices in particular, you must use the hardware, these provided tools. So to provision the device, you must bring your own Windows enterprise, 8 enterprise Vim image. The image can be just as simple as just brand new, you know, install image, or you can create your own custom image and put all your applications and all updates and create the devices with that image. But as I'd like to repeat, these devices, they don't come with Windows operating system. You must bring your own Windows operating system and create and use that image. The sparse provisioning tool, they come into two forms. One is wizard-based provisioning GUI tool, which is very, very similar to Microsoft's one. And also, you can use PowerShell scripts if you'd like to have silent provisioning. But both these tools, or both these methods, they do the same thing. They create the encrypted device, a bootable device. Also, if you have multiple, if you want to provision multiple units, you can do it 8 units at a time. Of course, if you have 8 USB ports on your computer. So when you provision the device, it will go through the process. And the first thing it does, it will unlock the SPW device. It will create two compartments. One is clear, one is encrypted. Then it will load all the, you know, clear components, such as TAF bootloader and other elements. For the encrypted compartment, it will create encryption keys and have them ready for encryption. Also, during the process, you need to set that bootable, the password that you provide the user to boot the device. And then it will load your Windows image on the encrypted partition, and it creates the bootable Windows structure. Optionally, you can set Microsoft BitLocker key, the password for that, if you want to enforce the BitLocker encryption as well. And optionally, you can join all these devices into your domain straight from the provisioning tool. And let me quickly show you the provisioning process. So for yes, we'll cover that as well, yes. So I have my device. Bob, can you give me, please, your
new
spare device?
Okay.
Thank you. So let me switch to this machine. So here I have my Windows 8 64-bit enterprise version. And my sparse new USB that I want to provision. So I plug it into the spare USB port, and I have the shortcut here. So this is a provisioning, sparse provisioning tool. So I run as administrator, and yeah, of course we need to agree with the license. So next thing, it will tell you that all USB devices that you plug in into this two USBs will be provisioned with the same image, but it will create different encryption keys for each of the device. So every device has its own encryption key, and every time you provision, it will create a new encryption key for that provisioning partition. So then it will give you a list of all the devices that you currently plugged in, just you verify that. And next, on the next screen, it will ask you to choose the Windows 8 image. So here you can use DVD if you have that, like in my example, or if you have it on the network share, you can search through the browsing. So let's select this my DVD image. And here we set the password. That boot password that you need to enter during the boot. Then we can choose the BitLocker if we want. Now let's not do it for now. And the domain name if you want to join these devices to the domain. And then it will present you with a summary, and if you click create, it will start create and encrypt these devices. So I'm not going to do it now, just for sake of time.
So Nadia, I have a question for you.
Another question, yeah.
How long does it take to provision my corporate SOE on the flash drive?
So to provision the drive, it actually depends on the different parameters. So the time provisioning depends on different parameters. One of them, the size of your image. So if it's a brand new image, which is like 3 gigabytes, would be faster. If you have your custom image with 30 gigabytes, it will be slower. Also, it depends on whether you're using USB 2 or USB 3.0. But just give you a rough idea that when I provisioned my just brand new installer image on USB 3, it took about 15 minutes.
Thank you.
Yes, you can use USB hub and plug in up to 8 units. So all your 8 units will be provisioned at the same time. And
question, sorry. What will happen with your non-encrypted partition if it's corrupted? Will the USB be unaccessible or something?
Yeah.
If it's okay with you, we promise to answer all the questions. We just want to quickly go through the last element of that, and I'll get back to you shortly.
Sorry, yeah. And so let's go back to presentation number one. So we looked at how to provision all these devices. And once you provision and give it to people, now you multiplied your SOE, all operating system and applications. And if you are a system administrator, I think you have a very good question. How do we manage all this, you know, operating system? And to answer the question is, to manage all these devices, I mean, operating system of the devices, you just need to do the same thing you do with any other laptop and desktop in your environment. And by saying that, I mean that first of all, it's better to deploy your custom WIM image with all your application pre-installed, with all security patches applied. And after that, your life will be easier. After you've deployed the custom image, then you just use your existing infrastructure. If you have Microsoft System Center, you can use it. Or if you have any other third-party tool to manage applications and operating system, you can use them as well. All application updates, security patches, Windows updates, all are done the same way as you currently do with any other desktop in your network. It can be done through a centralized server or maybe from the internet. Also, you can use group policies to apply user or system configurations. You can lock down the various settings on the operating system via group policies. Also, some people ask, how do we synchronize data on these USB sticks with other laptops or network? Because as we talked about, these sticks, they don't talk to the hard disks of the laptops. So an answer for that is you can use folder redirection to synchronize the files from the stick with your network shares or any other laptop. Or you can use SkyDrive, of course. For non-OS management, Sparse provides enterprise management system. So with this system, you can manage what's outside of the operating system and applications, such as you can register all the devices. You can disable the devices or enable them, or you can even destroy them. You remember how in Mission Impossible movie, all these gadgets, they explode after there is a mission? Well, something similar you can do with these devices as well. Of course, they won't explode, but all encryption keys Yeah, I wish. Yeah, all encryption keys will be destroyed and user won't be able to use that USB anymore. Also, you can configure different policies for passwords as well as for offline use. We'll look at this during the demo as well. And of course, it has auditing capabilities. The management system is a software, but is hardened with sparse developed hardware security modules. And this is very important for some organizations such as government and defense, when you don't want to, your software to be the weakest point in the entire infrastructure. So they provide the security for this system using hardware security modules for encryption. Also, for management systems administrators, you can have two-factor authentication for additional control and separation of duties. To deploy SAMs, so if you look at this as your network, I think some of you may dream that your network would look very simple, it would look like this, but just assume that this is it. So behind the firewall, you'll have your Windows to main controller with some few laptops. And you put your SAMs management system just behind the firewall, so the people inside and outside can come. Of course, you need to open a couple of ports for that. Then a security administrator would have their own administration console with two-factor authentication. And then you give your USB sticks to internal employees, and that SAMS client on the stick will talk to SAMS server and pick all the policies and configurations. If your employee is traveling and working from home, hotel, or cafe, they can use the public internet or VPN to access your SAMS server. And all policies and commands on operations from the SAMS management system will be pushed out to these devices as well. Now let's quickly have a look at the management. So what we are going to do, I have my management system on number 7. So number 7, so computer, I have my SAMS management system running in a virtual environment. So never remind me. So let me log in to this system. So here I have my Sparse Enterprise Management System console. This is a web-based console, so you can access it from any other laptop which your security administrator would use. So if I have my HSM also plugged in into this computer as well. And let me log in into the SAMS. Nadia. So once you're logged in, you'll see all the devices that you can manage. Currently I have only one, so I can see only one. But if you have more, you can. If you have hundreds, you can do search and manage all these devices. So here you can see who the owner of the device, so basically the user who is using this device and logged in and registered the device. Then you can see the state of the device, whether it's offline or online, where it's disabled or destroyed or active. And also you can see the last time when the user logged in into the device. So also you can do some policy configurations. So for policy configurations, you can assign different complexity for the passwords. You can have, you can enable, restrict how many lowercase characters or uppercase characters you want to use. Also, you can set up password duration lengths. So if you have the policy that requires to change the password after, you know, 90 days. Also, you can configure the offline logon attempts. So offline logon means that the user can use stick without connecting to your SEMS. And so for this example, I have 25, which means that I can access my SPW operating system 25 times without coming to the network and connecting to the SEMS. After, on the 26th time, it will give me a message that, sorry, you must come online, you must connect to the network to get synchronized with the management system. So this gives you control and ability to push new policies, to disable devices and enforce people to come and connect to your management system. Also, in the audit, you can see when people, you know, logged on, logged off, and also you can see when the device was registered. So now let's do something with the device. And I think, Bob, you better not to look at this, as I'm going to destroy my device.
Oh.
So I have my another device that already booted that I used for demo one. It's on the, let's check, it's on number two. Can we see number two? Yes, we can see number two. So let's go back to number seven. So here, I'll go into destroy this device. So I click destroy. Yes, I really want to destroy. And then let's go to the number two. And it's depending on the, you know, the network and the timing, it may take, you know, a minute or two to send that command to the user, to the actual device. So let's see what happens. So, but what should happen is it, when it gets the command, it should destroy the encryption keys and shuts down the operating system. I hope it happens, you know, quicker rather than, you know,
you
slower.
Watch video.
All right, so let's watch video. Maybe, yeah, I'll just lowish these horses, but
some serious destruction.
Yeah. But yeah, they should come anytime. And yeah, it should be soon. Yeah, it just gets it checks the and synchronizes with this every so often. So you never know when it can happen. But here on the my SEM it says pending. So
we are giving away three cards today, and these cards are 64 gig, and it's a fully provisioned, it's a full card, and all you need to do is use your Microsoft Enterprise 8 software, and away you go.
All right, so we finally here. So it says, get destroyed, the device hasn't been destroyed, cannot continue. So what happens after that? You know, let's have a look. So now let's boot from this device again and see what happens. So, and now we'll boot to number three again. Can we see number three? So the first thing, it looks similar. So let's type the correct password this time. Oh, sorry, I was... And here you say, sorry, your computer needs to be repaired.
So Nadia, oh, you really, really destroyed it. I thought you were only joking, because I intended to give that car to one of the audience over here.
Yeah, don't worry, Bob. The remote destroyer is actually designed to provide you with security. So when you need to destroy the card, when you need to protect your device, if it's been stolen or you're lost, this is what you do. And if you suddenly found it again, you can reprovision it the same way as we did during the demo too. So you don't need to be sad about this. This is what it's supposed to
Thank
do.
You. Good.
All right, so go to number one. Oh, this is for you. So let's...
Thank you very much, Nadia. So we've actually given you reasons on why you need to have a secure portable workplace. And we've also provided some statistics on Australian companies that are getting breached. And as I said, if you do need more details, feel free to email to me and I'll point out the URLs to you. And the fines are substantial as well. And I quoted on average Australian companies, and as I said, I'm not talking about the big companies here, I'm talking about the smaller companies, are storing, processing 200,000 records. And the number that has been quoted by Poneman Institute is $141 per record, so that's $2.8 million. So I would urge you to be vigilant when you are using your mobility BYOD type applications. When you combine the Spyrus portable workplace and Microsoft Windows Enterprise 8 Windows to Go, we are able to bridge the gap of mobility, BYOD, as well as security. You are now able to easily transport a computer that small into your back pocket. And certainly for the demo, we would have needed about six computers, and we've done that with two computers, and the rest were small footprint, which you may want to come and see later as to how we've set it up. I like this boot, compute, and scoot. With that, I'd like to open the floor for question and answers, and here's our details as well, contact details. And after the question and answers, we will announce the winners of the card as well. So we've got lots of questions. So this gentleman over here.
My previous one, which is about...
First one. Sorry, would you be kind enough to repeat that? Yeah.
It's pretty easy. Does every different vendor have proprietary software to be able to image the USB sticks? That's question one.
So the question is, there are different other vendors to provide the encrypted devices, and whether all these vendors require a separate provisioning tool. So the answer is that depending on the actual encryption, I think if they have hardware-based encryption, then they have to use their own provision tool. If it's software-based encryption, so depending on how they do that. So for some of them, you might be able to use Microsoft provision tool. For some of them, they still require that their own tool.
And the second question?
Can you stick a USB stick with Windows 8 into a Windows Surface RTM on Windows 8?
So question is, can you plug in the stick with Windows 8 into Surface RT tablet? And the answer is, so this is the Windows to Go requirements that the hardware must have CPU x86 or 64-bit. So it's those RTM tablets will not work. Yeah, this is unfortunately Microsoft restriction, so.
And I think there was a gentleman over here that had a question that we didn't answer. No? Okay.
One of the practical problems with this stick is it's too wide. When you plug this in and use it, some of the other ports get blocked. So I can't plug in my power on my ultrabook if I use this wide USB stick. I've used this stick before. So are you guys planning to have a smaller stick anytime soon?
The question is, this stick, when you plug it in, it will use the USB port. So you won't be able to use that port for any other devices anymore. So the answer is, you can use USB hub. differently.
Or a cable extension.
You know, to increase the number of USB ports. That's
sorry.
Yes. Have a question
yourself?
Here as well.
Zero security.
Yeah. So, well, the issue is we'd face now if more of these pop up, we'd have to find ways of actually working out where these flash drives come from, things like that. Have they been plugged into certain computers, etc. You say they leave no footprint, so that's fine. But, so my question is, you sent your kill command out. If we've retrieved one of these from particular place, you had to have it running. Is that still the case? So is it like an iPhone or other mobile devices that have to be on and running at the time for you to send them a kill command? So I could then take it away from your premises, put it in a Faraday bag, take it to my Faraday room and look at it there perfectly safe and secure.
So the question is, when to issue the kill command, does the computer require to be online and be, be running. So the answer is that you can issue the kill command anytime, definitely, but it only applied when the computer comes on to the network. So it can be offline at that moment when you issue the command, and next time when it comes online, connects to the network, it will be killed. If it cannot connect to the network, so depending on that offline login attempts number, it might boot, it might not boot, so depending on that number as well. Mm. But it must come online at some point of time, definitely. So we have, let's go to this site.
Okay, go ahead. Go ahead.
And ask a question here as well, sir. Yes, please. So for the group policies, how it's managed by group policies? So the answer is, this is a normal Windows operating system, right? So to be managed by the group policies or, you know, be logging to Active Directory, you need to join to the domain. So you can join to the domain during the provisioning time. When I showed you, you can choose to join this domain. So the host name will be randomly assigned to each device, and it will be registered with the domain.
So
the next time when the user boots from the device and then log in, it will go through that process.
So you can automate
it. Yes, so the join the domain can be automated during the provisioning time.
Gentleman next to you.
Normally, yes. How do we join the domain? Does the machine need to power up? So normally, yes.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah. You know, I was just thinking of the scenario. You provision one of these and you just want to stick it in the host.
Yeah.
But you just still have to power up.
Yes, so during the provisioning time, the provisioning tool, when it copies all the Windows files, it will join that at that moment. Because the provisioning machine must belong to the domain when you provision. So it will go through that machine and join those sticks through that machine.
At the time
when you provision, yeah.
So, yep.
Is there a way to recover a killed disk? Say, for example, CEO has run up and said, I've lost my disk, can you please kill it for me? And then he finds it in his back pocket.
So there is a way to recover when we kill the disk. So the answer is, so there are different options. You can disable or destroy the device. So if there is any chance that the device might be just somewhere in your bag and you may find it, I would suggest to do disable so the people cannot boot, cannot log in. In that case, you can re-enable it so you don't lose encryption keys. If you destroy, if you issue the destroy command, all encryption keys will be destroyed. And you cannot recover until if you didn't take a backup at the first place.
Yeah. Yes.
So as I mentioned, this is normal Windows 8 environment. So any application that you can put on your Windows 8 enterprise laptop can be put here as well. So depending, of course, on the size of the application, the size of the disk of this USB, but yeah, virtual applications definitely.
The demos that we did were running on that virtualized machine, yeah, as well as Windows Server and SQL database.
So we are using it right now.
Yes.
So the question is encryption happening before the provisioning or during the provisioning and uploading the Windows or after all that? So to answer that question, it was kind of a tricky question because you have to really go deep down to the and actually see how it's happening. But if you see the provisioning process, you'll see that the how it copies all the files and folders for Windows. And so but first of all, it creates that encrypted storage and decrypts it and copy the files and then, and locks it down. Yeah.
Yep.
So, about the non-encrypted partitions, is that protected? And if it is, something has happened, like it's corrupted, can we recover the key to be used?
For the clear partition?
Now, everything is being installed in USB.
Yep.
Will it be destroyed when you lost your unencrypted partition?
So the question is, there are two partitions, clear and encrypted. Will this device will be destroyed if clear partition is corrupted? That's right?
Yep.
So to answer that, so the clear partition contains the boot record and all these tough bootloader application as well. So you can actually mount that clear partition in normal Windows and see what's there. And potentially, probably you can, back it up in the future. But in reality, if it's something is missing or it's corrupted, it just won't boot. And you'll have to reprovision it in a normal case. Yeah, I would say so, yeah.
Well, just